The title of this sermon is Asked of Jesus, What is the First or Foremost Commandment of All? And the passage we're going to look at is Mark chapter 12, verses 28 through 34. Before I begin, in case you haven't gotten one of these little, actually it's a small little handout in the back there called Attributes of God, grab one on the back table there. If you've got them, that's good, because we'll be going over this. I think everybody's got one. You both have one? Who needs one? I will read the passage. Mark 12, verse 28. Jesus just finished talking, which we saw previously. He just finished talking with the Sadducees, who say there is no resurrection, and he refuted them so that they did not, their trap, they thought to catch him. It didn't work. It never works when people try to trap the Lord Jesus. Even the best legal minds in ancient Israel could not do this. And here, Jesus is continuing, because one of the scribes that was nearby asked him another question. But this is not the usual scribe. This is a more friendly one. Verse 28 of Mark 12. And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, perceived that he, Jesus, had answered them well, asked him, which is the first or foremost commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, the first of all the commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like it, namely this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is none other commandment greater than these. Verse 32. And the scribe said to him, Well, master, you have said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but He. And to love Him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love His neighbor as Himself, is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, or answered well, he said to him, You are not far from the kingdom of God. And no man after that dared to ask him any question. This is the word of God. So, who is this scribe? In Matthew, chapter 22, verse 35, Matthew calls him a lawyer, that is, a law expert. And this man is not hostile, but respectful, friendly, and approving of Jesus' answer. In verse 29, Mark includes the first saying of Jesus, the full saying of Jesus, as he quotes Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, and then in a moment, verse 5, what is called the Shema. This is what the Jews call the Shema. Shema means hear. And it starts with that word, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Affirming that there is but one God. We will talk a little bit about the Trinity in a moment. So he continues then in verse 30 with the command, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first, the foremost, the most important commandment. Now, I want to bring this to your attention and to look at this more closely. This loving the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our mind, that is, with all our understanding. Because how can we love him if we don't know him? Okay, we all that are born again Christians, we know him. But there's a difference from how I know him now, after some 55 years of belonging to him, and when I first started. I knew him truly the day I was converted. A woman was preaching to me, and as she preached, the Holy Spirit moved upon my heart to believe, to be aware, to be alive to God. So I knew him. But we can love him better if we know him better and more deeply. What we will do now is consider some of the attributes of God. Attributes are qualities or characteristics of a person. And here, this is attributes of his person. The little handouts that you have, and on the YouTube, I will attach a link to the handout so that folks can see it there. They will show some of what are called the attributes of God. Now, I'm glad that we don't have any children, little ones today here. Because we don't want to be distracted by this. These are some of the attributes. I'll run them down very quickly. Eternality, immutability, omnipresence, omniscience, omnipotence or omnipotence, holiness, and goodness. These are characteristics that God is in himself, apart from his creation. And then we will get a couple of attributes with regard to his creation, that is, us and the world. Eternality. In Psalm 92, in Psalm 90, verse 2, this is written. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Now, consider this for a minute. Everlasting. That's eternity. Everlasting. Infinity, so to speak, going back. Eternity going forward. Endless. God has existed from eternity, forever, always. Before the world was created. God existed. There never was a time when there was no God. And this God is a good God. That he existed always before anything was created, before anything he did. It boggles the mind. He always existed, and he always will. He always will, but now his creation, he will make it full of glory and wonder and joy. And he will be with us. He will be blessing. He will be present in his creation fully forever. And that's us with him. It will be an eternal honeymoon in the love of our Savior, our spiritual husband, the Lord Jesus. Immutability. Immutable means unchanging. I read from Psalm 102, verses 25, 26, and 27. Of old, you have laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They shall perish, but you shall endure. Yes, all of them shall wax old like a garment. As a vesture or piece of clothing, you shall change them, and they shall be changed. But you are the same, and your years shall have no end. God, who is perfect, infinitely perfect, holy, and good, does not change. Nothing can be added to him. Nothing can be taken from him. He is the eternal, infinite God. He may change his dealing with human beings or with angels according as how they are conducting themselves, but in his essence, he does not change. He is forever the good, gracious, loving God. That God, the God, the only God, should be such a God as we know, a good God. I'm just very thankful for that. Omnipresence. Omnipresence means present everywhere. We will come across this prefix to the word, a word, omni, in the next two attributes. Omnipresence. Jeremiah 23, verse 24. Can any hide himself in secret places that I shall not see him, says the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, says the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth? Before God created, God was all that there was. God. These are things too great for our minds really to conceive. And then he created the universe. He created all that exists, and everything created is distinct and separate from God. Even though God fills it, it is distinct. There is the creator and there is the creation. What we call the activity of God within himself eternally is called the immanent Trinity. Immanent means inherent within himself, not external. Distinct from this is the economic. These are just theological terms, how God deals with his creation. He fills all creation. The very galaxies that are out there. Omniscience is another way of saying all-knowing. Psalm, and I give you just one little scripture for each one of these, even though there are many. Psalm 147, verses 4 and 5, he tells the number of the stars. He calls them all by their names. Great is our God, great is our Lord, and of great power. His understanding is infinite. He tells the number of the stars. Our sun is a small yellow dwarf star. Astronomers call that's what they, the type of star. It's a small star, our sun. There are billions of stars in the multiplied millions of galaxies. And he knows the name of each one of them. He created each and every one of them. His understanding, his knowledge is infinite. Omniscience. How does God know? In one intuitive act, he knows everything from eternity back and eternity forward. In one intuitive act, he knows all that is to be known, all that is. There is nothing he does not know. He is eternal. He is the expanse of him is infinite. And his knowledge is infinite. This is an infinite, eternal God with whom we have to do. And yet, he gave the eternal Son, three persons in the Trinity, in the essence of God, the essence of the one God, the one being of God, He gave his son, the eternal son, to be born in the womb of a human woman. In the womb of Mary. The eternal God took on a human nature. The deity, so to speak, married or joined a human nature in the person of Christ, who is full deity and full human. They are not mingled or mixed. The two natures, the divine and the human, constitute the one person of Jesus Christ. The fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in Christ. The fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in Christ. We are joined, those who are his, we are joined, united to the body of Christ. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 30, we are bone of his bones and flesh of his flesh. The modern translations exclude flesh of his flesh, but it's in there in the King James and the New King James. That's the best Greek and Hebrew scriptures, those underlying those older versions. God joined humankind. Omnipotence or omnipotence. Potent means strength. Omni, all. Infinite strength. Now consider this. The sun, our little small yellow dwarf star, the center of our solar system, is 27 million degrees Fahrenheit. Or if you use centigrade, 15 million degrees centigrade. 1/2 billionth of its energy, 1/2 billionth of its energy is needed to heat the planet Earth. Such a minuscule, minute part of the vast power is needed to heat this planet. And we know that the heat of this planet, the sun, can be very strong. The energy to create a sun like our small sun. The energy of the sun is about equal to 1 megaton nuclear bombs exploding every second. That's the energy that is generated by the sun, which is a huge thermonuclear furnace, constantly exploding, sending out its tremendous energy, and at the same time, it has a very strong magnetic field, a gravity, a perfect balance of the energy going out and the energy being held in. It's a wonder of technology, but it's not technology, it's God's creation. The sun emits. We know about bulbs and the bulbs we put in our lamps. 45 watts, 20 watts, 100 watts. The sun emits 400 trillion watts per second. in just 1 second, the sun produces enough energy in just 1 second to power our current level of civilization globally for 500,000 years every second. And God made the sun. And this is one small sun. There are bigger suns in other galaxies, in other solar systems. He made these things. How great is this God? He's our God. Holiness. The absolute moral perfection of God. No darkness in him at all. 1 John 1:5. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. He is the rock, the stable strength. His work is perfect. For all his ways are justice, a God of truth and without iniquity. Just and right is he. The holiness of God is torment and terror to the demonic realm. In John chapter 3, the Lord says this. God sent his son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Verse 18, that was 17. He that believes on him is not condemned. But he that believes not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men loved darkness, rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that does evil hates the light, neither comes to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed and rebuked. But he that does truth, who loves truth, comes to the light, that his deeds may be made known that they are wrought in God. There are some that hate the moral perfection of God. This infinitely good God, when he sees sin and darkness ruining his creation, ruining the beauty and the purity of his creation, attacking him and his children of light, because he is a good God, he destroys that which is evil to cleanse the creation from darkness and sin and wickedness, violence, injustice. Consider the commandments of God. The last six pertain to dealings with humans. Love your mother and your father. Honor them. Do not steal. Do not kill. Do not commit adultery. Do not lie. Do not covet that which belongs to somebody else. God wants us to be clean and pure. And if we kept those, that would be a big difference in how the world was. But we see what the world is like now. God is holy, and his heart is set. Evil is having its way now. God allows it. It's a furnace. Evil is a furnace to the godly to try us, to purify us, to make us fit for his holy kingdom. But there's coming a day when there will be no more evil. It will be destroyed. His holiness will destroy evil. And new earth on which heaven shall come down, upon which God shall dwell, Jesus, the glorious Son of God, will walk on the new earth with us. He will be on the planet earth, a new planet earth. Goodness is another of his attributes. He is just, righteous, holy, pure, gentle, and kind. Purity is freedom from anything that contaminates. Purity is the quality of being faultless, uncompromised, or unadulterated. Psalm 52:1, the goodness of God endures continually. The goodness of God refers to the perfection of his nature. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. There is such an absolute perfection in God's nature and being that nothing is wanting or lacking to it or defective in it, and nothing can be added to make it better. He is the ultimate good. God is goodness itself. Very briefly, I'll touch upon just a little bit. I wanted to talk about the immanent, that is, within the Godhead, apart from creation. But I'll talk very briefly about the what's called the economic Trinity, their actions in the creation. Sovereignty. God is sovereign or has dominion. Psalm 103, verse 19. The Lord has prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. God rules and works for good. All things in his creation for those that love him. Romans 8:28, God works all things for good to them that are called according to his purpose and who follow him. He works all things, even the evil. Evil has been done against some of us, and those who hear this will understand, and which have experienced evil. But it is meant for our good, to purify us, to teach us, to help us grow, to help us learn patience, learn endurance. Another of his, what we call economic attributes, meaning having to do with the creation, is patience. Patience is long suffering, slow to anger. A theologian, Stephen Charnock, said it is part of the divine goodness and mercy, yet differs from both of them. A.W. Pink said of patience, the patience of God is that excellency which causes him to sustain great injuries without immediately avenging himself. When Jesus was about to be killed, he said, do I not have the power to call legions of angels to come and protect me? But it was for this hour of evil seeming to have the victory that I came into the world to suffer and die for sins. He suffered patiently, enduring the mistreatment, the torture of men, and then the wrath of God, bearing our sins upon himself, the wrath of God against that sin. He, the sin bearer, the lamb that takes away the sin of the world. Slow to anger, patient. And we haven't spoken even, and I'm not going into this, I could, about his kindness, compassion, love, forgiveness, the atonement, and the redemption of us. These are some of the attributes. I wanted to touch upon the greatness of our God. We are little, less than little, and he is infinite. And yet, the scripture says, what is man that thou art mindful of him? He is mindful of us. He loves us. He cares for us. He cherishes us. We didn't deserve it. Why does he love us? Why did he choose to save those who are saved? It was his good pleasure. We will understand these things better as we get older, and eventually more fully when we get to see him. In verses 32, verse 31, Jesus, quoting from Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, there is a second great commandment. We went from the first great commandment, love the Lord your God with all you are. Verse 31 says, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, saying, there is no other commandment greater than these. Matthew adds to this, saying, he also heard Jesus talking, and he Mark sometimes abbreviates, and Matthew fills in a little more, and vice versa. Matthew has Jesus say, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. We are commanded to love others as we love ourselves. This is what we are to aim for as we grow in Christ-likeness. Sitting under the preaching of the gospel, hearing other Christians talk, reading the scriptures for yourselves, you will grow to know how to love others, to be kind, to be generous, to be merciful, to be forgiving. We live, Christians, we live by God's forgiveness. Marriages stay together because the husband forgives the wife forgives the husband. I'm not a perfect person. I'm not a perfect husband. Our marriage works, Paula and me, because she forgives me and I forgive her. It's so important. We need to do this. Friendships, just friendships, not marriages even, but friendships. Children and parents, we forgive each other. Parents set the example, forgiving their children, and the children say, oh, that feels so wonderful that I did something wrong and you forgave me for it. They learn from their parents, and the parents say, well, I learned this from Jesus because I did wrong and he forgave me for it. We learn from God's love to love others. This is why we honor our parents, because God put them into our lives, especially Christian parents, godly parents especially, to teach us, to help us grow in Christ-likeness and to inherit the everlasting kingdom of God. It's coming, a great day of judgment. The sheep on the one hand, the goats on the other hand. We want our children to be among the sheep that inherit paradise. In verses 32 and 33 of Mark 12, the scribe earnestly approves, commends what Jesus has said, repeating it back with a slight addition. Verse 34, when Jesus saw how well and sincerely the scribe answered him, he encourages him by saying, you are not far from the kingdom of God, and urging him to enter it. What would entail his entering the kingdom of God? To become a disciple of Jesus. To become a disciple. That's how this scribe, and there were many scribes who came to Jesus, there were many priests who were converted, the Jewish priests, who were converted and became Christians, followers of the Messiah. Mark closes the account of this incident by saying this. After that, after his encounter with this scribe, no man dared to ask him any other question. No one dared to ask Jesus to try and trap him again, to catch him in a mistake. He made no mistakes, our Lord. No one dared. All of them were embarrassed. They only had one way to deal with Jesus. That was to kill him. They couldn't trick him or refute him. But Jesus knew that, and he was willingly giving his life. They wanted to kill him. Jesus wanted to go to the cross to bear our sins, to rescue his bride. That's the church, the mystical body. Jesus had a passion to get to that cross, to bear the sins of his people, to rescue his bride, to do the will of the Father. I would encourage you to keep in mind, to ponder, to meditate on the attributes of God we spoke of. And there are books which talk more about this. I can send you links to books with online PDF. You can read them on your phones or your computers. Keep in mind these attributes. How great the God is whom we serve, to help us understand him and love him better. Remember also, these will be my last words, remember also what Jesus told Philip in John 14, verse 9. He that has seen me has seen the Father. He that has seen me has seen the Father. That is, the very heart and spirit of the eternal, infinite God was present in Christ. Jesus said, I and the Father are one. We call these the inseparable operations of the three persons of the Trinity. I and the Father are one. When we see Jesus, with our faith or hear him in the scripture, we are hearing the Father. Let me pray. Thank you for your word. Thank you for who you are. O great God, our Father, King of heaven and earth, ruler of all the universe, lover of your children on this planet, thank you for your word. Thank you for sending your Son, whose birth we celebrate tonight and tomorrow, Jesus, born of the Virgin in a stable in Bethlehem. Thank you, Lord. Amen.